two-parter because it was a pretty long conversation. Today we talked to Rick Lonow, the drummer from Poco. First part, mostly talking about the origin story of Call It Love, talking about arriving in Nashville, talking about how Nashville is different from other towns in terms of the way that it treats celebrity, talking about the Burrito Brothers, Burrito Deluxe, some of the projects that Rick worked on in his early years here in Nashville. Enjoy the conversation. There will be a part two. Thanks for tuning in.
You know, well, I mean, I played, you know, I mean, I met Jack through this guy that I was playing with, Craig Bickhart.
Oh, I don't really know Craig, but I've met.
But I mean, that's how I got to know Jack initially, was through Craig, because Craig and Jack had this idol wheel thing that they do.
Yeah.
And he went through all the same stuff. I mean, for a minute, yeah, and it seems to be cyclical. It seems to be, you know, you get a little traction, and then you get a little traction, and you get hot, and then, you know, after a while, you know, there's always somebody coming up behind you in that same circle.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. And I, you know, as a songwriter, you look at your own catalog and you see, God, I got some good songs. Mm-hmm. And when they pulled Call of Love out, and that happened, that was just happened through the studio where we had recorded it. When I just thought, shit, that's not even one of our best songs, you know. Sure, they can have that one, you know. And then, so I thought, well, now we got that one. We've got a bunch of other shit. We're about to take a ride here. And it never happened. The ride never happened. They did Call It Love, and we're throwing all the other songs out there. And as a writer, that's hard to accept. When you're throwing it out there and it ain't sticking.
Especially when you're thinking, the thing that I just wrote. And then the trap that happens after that is like, well, if that's not one of my best songs, then maybe I need to try to rewrite this song again because that's what they like.
Yeah, yeah. That kills it right there. And once you start trying to do what they want, then you've already shot yourself in the foot.
Yeah.
For me, the best part of all that ride, of the Call It Love ride, was that I didn't come here to be a songwriter. Mm-hmm. I came here to be a drummer, but I wanted to be in a band. And Ronnie and Billy and I had already created our idea that we were going to have a band. And it wasn't just the three of us. It was the three of us with Ray Capio on bass, the four of us to start with. And then later, Billy's brother, Tommy Crane, joined the band. We had a five-piece band for a pretty long time. Stick Davis joined on bass after Ray moved back to California. But I just wanted to be in the band. But Billy and Ronnie and I were writing pretty much all, not every one of the songs, but pretty much all the songs. And that was the writing team. And it was just a fluke. Our friend Jimmy Davis was writing with Rusty in 1990.
Okay.
Or 89. I guess probably 89, 88. He was writing with Rusty in Memphis, Tennessee. Jimmy's from Memphis. And we were working at a place called Sounds Unreal for a guy named John Horniak. We weren't working for him. John was giving us time. Mm-hmm. All on spec. He just thought we had a great sound, thought we had some good songs, thought it was probably going to go somewhere. He was helping get labels come hear us and everything. Through all of that, somehow Jimmy Davis tells Rusty about this song he just heard. He said, man, I know we're writing something for your new album, but man, I heard something those guys did, it sounds unreal, that freaking, it sounded like Poco. You guys, you ought to hear this. Rusty liked it. Rusty pitched it to RCA. It became the lead single on the Legend album.
Cool.
Or Legacy album. Legacy album.
So did you come here with Ronnie and Billy?
Or not exactly. I came here with Billy. Okay. Ronnie, but I know Ronnie older. His dad is Gib Gilbo, and who I played with in the Flying Burrito Brothers.
Right.
So, but Ronnie, I actually was playing with Ronnie, and Ronnie got me the gig with his dad, because we'd been hanging out together in Palmdale, where we're both from. And then, after I'd worked with the Burritos, we lost a record deal, everything was falling, or they had lost a record deal, I wasn't a signatory on that record deal, and that had fallen apart, and they recommended me, John Beal recommended me for the Bellamy Brothers gig, and Billy Crane was in the Bellamy's gig. And
that seems like an odd match.
Florida was the connection.
Okay.
And they pretty much had a rock band, two guys. Actually, they had three guys from Henry Paul's band, offshoot of the Outlaws, Florida.
In the Bellamy's?
In the Bells, the drummer, Billy, and the bass player, Wally Dentz, all from Henry Paul's band.
Were they in the version of the Henry Paul band that cut Grey Ghost and all those records?
I think it's the same guys for all the albums. And, what's Bill's last name? Bill, the drummer, I replaced him. He left the Bellamy's, and I became the Bellamy's drummer. But those two guys stayed. And then I was hanging out with Ronnie, and every time we come to Nashville, after a while, Ronnie and I started writing songs together. And after a while, I'd been riding with the Bellamy's for a while, and I loved those guys. But I didn't want my career to go that way. I wanted Wanted to get off the bus and do
you
something.
Wanted to be in an actual band.
In an like actual a band, where I'm not their drummer, but I'm the. Right. It's my. I'm in the band.
Right.
And so Ronnie and I started writing songs and putting together and played some stuff for Billy, and he liked it and wanted to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. So then we started writing with the three of us, and that all turned into. I mean, Call It Love was something that I was still in the Bellamy's. Billy and I were still in the Bellamy's band when we wrote that song. Wrote most of it one night. All wrote off of the lick. Mm-hmm. Billy, what we were doing, I bet a bunch of guys do this. We'd all share cassette tapes with each other of stuff we thought were good ideas.
Sure.
And Billy had one idea that Ronnie and I both liked, and it was that guitar lick. Dink a ding ding a ding ding ding.
Yeah.
And it all grew off of that. And so then that became the writing formula, and then it was like, you know what, Billy? Let's leave the Bellamy's now. We got a bunch of songs. Let's go do this band thing. And so we both quit the Bellamy's on the same day. And it's kind of funny. Now, it's all different for Billy because he's from the Nashville. He's from Nashville. So he's coming back home.
Well, Billy and Tommy, you know, Tommy was the lead guitar player in the Charlie Daniels band.
Exactly.
For a long time.
For a long time. So, 15 years.
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, they're here already.
They're well known. They're well known guitar.
That's why I was curious guys. How you fell into that crowd, because you know, when did you come to town?
I came to town in 89, summer of 89.
Okay, so you're getting here as you're putting those songs together
yep.
with Billy and Ronnie.
Yep,
and
that's part of why, that's why I'm coming. I'm
okay.
coming to finish that. That's why I'm bringing a little bit of money, when not near enough it turned out. But
nobody ever does. Nobody ever does.
And came just figuring, well, okay, now we're going to put this band together. It's obviously going to be great. We're obviously going to get a record deal. We're all going to be millionaires, and here we go.
Because that's how it works.
Isn't that how it works?
That's why we're here, right? So did anything ever come to fruition with that band, with Ron?
Not really. I mean, we got a bunch of record labels came and saw us, and they didn't see the charisma. We didn't have the it factor. We did have songs, and we were good at producing our songs. You should hear the demo Call It Love. It's note for note, the record.
Well, I mean, at that point in time, you know, that's right in the middle of the whole, you know, Garth Brooks renaissance, when, you know, Garth and Vince Gill and what Steve Earle calls the great credibility scare, when people were actually signing acts like Kevin Welch,
yeah.
you know, and people like that that, you know, weren't necessarily going to be on CMT or on the Nashville Network, as it was known then. Yeah, they were actually, for a minute, you know, willing to take chances on acts like that.
We were trying for
guys.
A rock and roll deal, though.
Uh-huh.
We were courting New York and L.A. Okay. Even though we were here, it made sense to be here to all of us, partly because Billy was from here, Ronnie already lived here, and I was ready to get out of band, and this seemed like a good spot to me, too. I'd already lived in L.A., and that I didn't think that was going to be the spot. My kids were still pretty little. Mm-hmm. And even though I wasn't married, I still spent a lot of time with my kids, and this seemed like the right place. They were like 7, 8, 9 years old at that time, maybe not even that old. And this was the right place. It turned out great. It was a good decision.
So, some point around, again, you're notoriously kind of a bit of a ghost on the internet. There's not a whole lot. You and I literally...
If you Google my name, I know I'm there somehow. But.
You're there, but it's just kind of like reading a resume. So I kind of feel like this is like a speed dating thing. Like I'm literally getting to know you as we're having this conversation, because we haven't known each other.
Yeah, that's right. That, I guess that's true. Yeah.
So there was some time that went by between 1990, when you guys, you know, were trying to shop this band, and when you had that initial songwriting success. And you ended up in the Burritos after that?
Again, it's like... I was still in the picture, and Ronnie's dad was working with us. He introduced us to John Horniak, and why we were connected to Memphis was all through Gib Gilbo.
Okay.
And so we're still hanging. We're trying to get a record deal. It isn't working, but we're getting labels. Everyone's really being cordial, and we're getting pretty high-end people are coming to see us. But it still isn't coming together. And then at some point, there's always Burrito Brother work comes and goes at different times. And so Gib would call me for those things, and next thing you know, that started getting busy again. And Sneaky Pete comes back in the band, because he's seeing that it looks like fun. We're going to France. We're doing some cool stuff. Mm-hmm. And so Pete takes off from his animation schedule, and whenever we're working in Europe or doing something good, and that starts happening again. There's a record, Southern Nights, comes out during that. I think that's the title. It may not. Sundered Tracks might be the title.
Okay.
So we got one record that comes out on the, under the name of the Burrito Brothers. And then,
well, there was a version of the Burrito Brothers that was on MCA in like the early 80s.
That's who I'm working for at
with
first.
With John and Gibb, because...
But then when Pete comes back, it turns into the Flying Burrito Brothers.
Right.
But what I originally was working for in 85 was the Burrito Brothers, John and Gibb.
Right.
The two of them.
Yeah.
Because Steve Bass has already left, and
yeah,
and I'm in that band.
I was working for the radio station in my hometown, and I was playing those songs like Does She Wish She Was Single Again?
Yeah.
And, you know, those tunes from that MCA record.
I'm trying to think of Drinking Canada Dry.
Yeah.
Let me think.
Yep.
Yeah.
But I specifically remember that one particular song, When She Was Single, Her Pockets Would Jingle, She Wore Such Pretty Clothes.
Oh.
Yeah, my brain is full of that stuff. Like, I could use that space for something like Tort Law and go out into the world and make some money. But no, I've got to remember, you know, the names of obscure Burrito Brothers records that I played on the radio. But, you know, I knew of that particular incarnation, and then there was another incarnation that you were involved in the 2000s. Called Burrito Deluxe.
Burrito Deluxe was...
That was with Garth Hudson and Stick Davis from the Amazing Rhythm Aces on bass.
And Sneaky Pete again. Yeah.
So I'm kind of curious about that particular band, because you've got two of the most infamous musical savants in modern musical history in the same outfit with Garth Hudson and Sneaky Pete.
Because I agree.
Two guys were, you know, I mean, I've heard stories from people who had Garth play on records that, you know, he would stand there and watch people erase like the outtakes. He didn't want them to have anything except the tape that he approved, and he wanted to make sure all of the rest of it was gone.
Yeah, that's probably
like
true.
That.
Well, we're band members, so I'm not exactly in that exact situation, but yes, he has a very interesting formula for the studio. But I mean, I've worked on a lot of records, and Garth's thing is unique to the way Garth does it. Anyway,
yeah, nobody else like him for sure.
No, he's such an individual voice. And that was the beauty of that band. That's the brainchild of Tommy Spurlock, a record producer, steel player, guitar player from this, well, not from here, but who I met in this town.
Mm-hmm.
He came to me one time, we were just having drinks somewhere, told me he was going to work on a record with Sneaky Pete Kleinow. Hey, didn't you used to be in the Burritos? I go, hell yeah, but Sneaky Pete's one of my close friends. I mean, how far are you along with the record? Mm-hmm. Here's what I want to do. I want to put a band together with Pete. I don't think that, you know, everybody just talks about the Flying Burrito Brothers, Graham Parsons. I think that there's this whole other story, Flying Burrito Brothers, Sneaky Pete Kleinow. I think that steel guitar was really important. This is Tommy speaking to me, and I go, I'm in. I fully agree.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be in the band. And he goes, all right, let's get going. And so we get going. Has the same conversation with Garth Hudson, who knows Pete from L.A. from days, from the day, when both those bands, the Flying Burrito Brothers and the band, were killing it out there, inventing, you know, country rock and all that. So Garth plays on a couple of tracks. I think we just hired him to play on one track. He gets into the session and just goes, well, is this a band? You know, he joins the band. So we're just going, we got a band. and then Stick Davis, kind of the same thing. Stick wasn't that busy, and he had been playing with me with Billy and Ronnie.
Sure.
And so I said, you know, I got a guy, I mean, this is all a bunch of resumes. I got the guy with an amazing rhythm bass, one of my closest friends, fantastic bass player. Let's get him. And everybody says, yeah, sounds perfect. So that was the band.
I always seem to be attracted to musical underdogs, and I always wondered, that's another band that I always wondered why they weren't bigger than they were.
The Amazing Rhythm Aces.
Oh, yeah.
Oh my God, yeah. I was such a fan. Russell's voice is so incredible, and the songs are such great songs.
Yeah, and I discovered them about the same time when I was working at the radio station in my high school.
Yep.
Somebody had a copy of Two Step to Jump, and yeah, there were a couple of other things in there, and I found a 45 at The End Is Not in Sight.
Me too.
Like there's no, you know, this is like a J.J. Cale record. There's nothing on the bones of this, but it sounds amazing.
Yeah, that was a great treat of me moving here. I got doing say one of the first guys to call me was Barry Bird Burton, the guitar player from those albums, and then meeting Stick, and then just I mean that and now it's a long you know all of us. You move here and there's all these famous people and there's guys that you used to look up to or I still look up to them, but now I call them by first name.
Well, that's one of the things that, you know, like, you have these conversations with people who live other places.
Yeah.
And you kind of become desensitized to it, you know.
I know. Yeah.
I had this same conversation with George when I talked to him for this thing.
Yeah.
Like, you know, it's one thing to live in another town and to, like, have, you know, I don't know, David Hasselhoff walk in and it's like, oh my God, that's David Hasselhoff. But, you know, when you go to the pancake pantry for breakfast every day and there sits Waylon Jennings and Roger Miller coming off a 38-hour bender, you know, it's just like, really, you know, it's just another thing.
Yeah.
You know, you don't think about it the same way here that you do in other places because it's just everywhere.
Yeah.